Dear sir, we are live. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much, Harish. Thank you so much. So good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends from across the nation. So friends, as you all know that ASSOCHAM JAM Green Building Council is organizing a 3 days virtual and 2 days physical JAM 4th International Conclave Expo and Awards 2021. So friends, this is a 3 days virtual program. Today is the second day. Yesterday was inaugural and one session by Karnataka and Maharashtra chapter. And 2 days physical conclave exhibition and awards will be held at India Habitat Center, New Delhi. So friends, today is the first session of the day and the topic is restoration of heritage buildings. And for the discussion, we have a galaxy of speakers with us. And this session is being organized by ASSOCHAM JAM Gujarat chapter and Odisha chapter. We have the dignitaries from Gujarat and Odisha as well. So friends, this entire conclave and supported by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India, Council of Architecture, NAREDCO, National Book Trust, and we have our principal platinum and gold partners, Prince, Panasonic, Lubrizol, Blazemaster, Mehta Tubes, Inner and ALP, and others. So I'll not take much time and would request Mr. Pankaj Dharkar, Chairman ASSOCHAM JAM Green Building Council, President Pankaj Dharkar and Associates for his technical discussion. Over to you, Mr. Dharkar.
Thank you, Nitji. Can I have a screen share, please?
Yes, sir. You have.
You can see the screen, sir?
Yes, sir.
So good morning to all of you, and my special thanks to Upendra Nath ji, Bera Saab, for accepting our invitation. Thank you so much, and thank you our Orissa chapter chair, Mr. S.S. Ray and Anand Tatu ji, also Lokendra ji, for coming together with Orissa, a amalgamation of east to west, and fantastic day to start with a very important subject, restoration of heritage buildings. I think we all know that we have a legacy. India has been doing and adopting and have set a benchmark for passive systems. And it has been a very unfortunate situation that though all these systems were and the buildings were so well designed generations ahead, we have lost somewhere, and the green building certification comes to us from the US. I think we should have been the leader, and we should reach that leadership position soon is the objective of ASSOCHAM JAM. And keeping that in mind, I think Gujarat chapter did this subject very well earlier, and now again reinforcing from Orissa, which is also having fantastic examples, beautiful temples. I think today's presentation is going to be eye-opener for many of us. So thank you, Gujarat and Orissa, thinking alike and selecting a subject which is very dear to all of us at ASSOCHAM JAM. And we all aware that in past, during pandemic, we did focus this subject, because while the new buildings, a lot of things can be done, but how do we make our old buildings alive? How do we learn from them, and how do we certify them to become examples of best possible certification situation? Because these are all buildings which to me are beyond normal 5GEM or a LEED Platinum or a LEED certification. They are all buildings which will qualify for net zero or going positive. So a lot of learning from these buildings, and thank you so much once again for selecting this subject. I think it will be unfair if we don't recognize our partners. Also, we will have Shriji Pandeji speaking about it. So thank you so much for being with us. Friends, I will be fast on our introduction because I know sir is very busy, and Upendra ji, I would like to update you that the ASSOCHAM has 400 chambers and we have 4.5 lakhs members across the country, and we believe that this mission of sustainability, we will be able to take it forward with the strength of this membership. We have been serving nation from 1920, and with that initiative GEM started 3 years back, creating this important objective to create this GEM sustainability certification program to take care of Mother Earth. Our program is based on ECBC 2017 and NBC 2016. To us, these are two wonderful documents which our Indian architects and engineers have provided to the globe. Our program takes care of sustainability, energy and water, indoor air quality, daylight, fresh air, more green areas, human comfort, and to me, one of the most important key area where this certification differs from other certification is fire and life safety. We do believe that the buildings have to be energy efficient, they have to consume less power, but also ensure that they are safe from fire and life safety point of view. Our program complements the United Nations 2030 SDGs. You will be glad to know that recently in COP26, our Mr. Neeraj Arora ji, along with our SG, were there to understand more comprehensively, and we were very fortunate to find ourselves that this is the first comprehensive rating system in the world to recognize sustainability rather than incorporating few components of it. If you really see this 17 goals which are set by United Nations, our program takes care of most of it automatically. To summarize, it is in alignment with COP26 objectives, clearly taking care of actively managing potential impacts on environment and local community, provide an accessible and inclusive setting for all, encourage healthy living, ensure a safe and secure atmosphere, encourage more sustainable behavior, leave a positive legacy. Friends, all GEM projects will have advantage of having a good payback if they are conceived right at the concept stage. We do believe that architects can do fantastic job in passive architecture, which can ensure there is no additional cost if engineers and architects start working from that day one in terms of its orientation, its all aspect. But if the building has some challenges, any certified buildings will give you 3 to 4 years payback. We do believe by adopting GEM, you are automatically ensuring water audits, waste audits, energy audits. This is a way forward for net zero and carbon neutrality. In terms of sustainability reporting and creating new generations training is also a wonderful opportunity which GEM is doing. Sir, we have currently 10 chapters in the country. You can see all green areas. We have Orissa chapter, we have Gujarat chapter, very dynamic leaders we are blessed with. And currently we are also coming up with these pink areas where advanced discussions are in place, but soon we want to cover entire country. We are now recognized by CRESIL, you can see, along with other certification agencies, and we have started getting recognition state by state. And here is the good news from Rajasthan. You can see here, the Rajasthan gives FAR advantage of 5% for GEM 3, 10% for GEM 4, and 15% for GEM 5. Our certifications start from GEM 1 to GEM 5, GEM being the lowest, GEM 1 being the lowest, and GEM 5 being the highest. Currently, we have done several types of projects. To give you examples, industrial giants in electrical and electronic, Siemens, fact, Abbott in pharmaceutical segment, luxury brand hotels of ITCs and DoubleTree Hilton, and several universities and factories. Some beautiful projects across the country have been certified by us. In fact, recently, Prime Minister Mr. Narendra Modi and the Railway Minister were at Kamalapati station at formerly known as Habibganj of Bhopal, which is the first redevelopment project. There were two developments, one at Bhopal and one other one was Gandhinagar near Ahmedabad, and both these are certified by GEM. You can see here at prominent location, the GEM certification is displayed in the main lobby of the railway station, and Prime Minister and railway ministers have really appreciated efforts of ASSOCHAM. You can see the media buzz about it. And this is a Leela Hotel above the Gandhinagar station. Many of you will visit vibrant Gujarat. This is going to be main venue along with Gandhi, the main exposition center. It is just opposite that. So many meetings will be held here. So we will, you will be able to see the good work done by GEM team. Friends, we have done to our credit a lot of affordable housing projects in UP, and also a very important land port terminal complex at Kartarpur, which is very much in news in last 15 days. This is also GEM certified. Several airports and also the metro terminals are being certified by GEM. We are constantly working with various societies. We do believe that it is a joint effort. Any building has component of engineering and architecture. So you can see here, we are working with the Indian Institute of Architects. We are working with Developer Society in Naredco. We are working with Fire and Security Association. We are working with TERE, which is a policy center headed by the former UNEP director. We are working with international societies like ASHRAE, IAQA, Lighting Society, Solar Society. Objective is to work together, including the Facility Managers Management Society of GACS. So we want that after the buildings are certified, they are also maintained on that. We have beautiful programs for youngsters. Neeraji, Shubh, and Amit are doing fantastic work. We train, we give online training free of cost to the professionals and students. And once you take this exam for 90 minutes, you can be qualified. This can happen 24/7 anytime digitally. Our objective is to reach the next generation. And in this, we had formed a Mission 100 during COVID time. And our team has done fantastic work, sir. We have reached 85 universities. We are sure within next 2 months, we will cross this 100 and we will set our new target. But our objective is to reach these young architects and young engineers. And you can see here across the country, we have multiple universities. Of course, we expect more to come from Gujarat and Odisha. Currently, the contribution is less than our expectation, but I'm sure soon we will be making it up. Maharashtra currently stops with Punjab in second number, but these are the focus area for ASSOCHAM GEM. Sir, we have in this pandemic, our team has done fantastic work. Doing more than 125 webinars, 125,000 registration, 101 lakh attendees with 10 new chapters and 14 professional organizations working with us with 85 universities. I think it is absolutely satisfying, but we don't want to stop here. We want to really take advantage of the current situation. And that is where we thought that we will blend our 5 days event, 3 days digitally, one which we are having today, and also physically in Delhi, and create a roadmap for future. So this is fantastic work being done by entire team, more than 90 plus speakers, eminent personalities. So let us friends come together and create a green and environmentally sustainable country, complement our country's vision, which we signed off in COP26, and let us do a joint effort. So thank you very much for joining us this morning, and thank you all of you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ji. Yeah, that's right. Like emphasis on restoration of heritage buildings, it's really a must, and that we are the world leaders. We are the world leaders in terms of green buildings, and we should have been the first one. Not right now, we are taking a lot of knowledges from outside, and right now ASSOCHAM is in the right way, right directions that we are trying to make indigenous. And thank you, sir, for illuminating us with ASSOCHAM GEM certifications program. So we have friends, we have a galaxy of speakers today. We have Architect Anand Tatu, Chairman SHN GEM Gujarat Chapter, Chairman Anand Tatu, Architects and Planners. We have Sri Upendra Nath Behraji, IAS, who will give us special address. He's the Chairman of the Odisha State Electricity Regulatory Commission, Government of Odisha. We'll have Sri Punesh Modiji, Honorable Minister of Road Building, Transport, Civil Aviation, Tourism and Pilgrimage Development, Government of Gujarat, as guest of honor, who will bless us with his message. And Professor SS Rai, with his speaks, who is a Chairman of SHN GEM Odisha Chapter and Director of School of Architecture and Planning at University. He will give he'll be the industry speakers and tell us about how rich heritage Odisha used to be and what we can take away from this kind of buildings. We have architect Lokendra Balseria with us, co-chairman SHN GEM Gujarat Chapter, founder of Tree Works and director of Second Alliance Foundation's partner, who will also illuminate us with his speech of regarding how the heritage buildings can be useful in terms of a lot of roadmaps in the green building sectors. We have sustainability partner, Ms. Sriti Pandeji, who is founder Structure Eco. So we'll learn a lot from her. And finally, we have Professor Sangram Mahanti, from co-chairman SHN GEM Odisha Chapter, architect, MEP and Green Consultant. So we'll start with our welcome address with the architect Anand Tatuji. So he's the chairman of SHN GEM Gujarat Chapter and chairman Anand Tatu, architect and planners. So welcome, sir.
Thank you, Shob. Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the Gujarat and Odisha chapter of SHN GEM, I welcome the dignitaries, the distinguished speakers, event supporters, and all the participants for showing your concern regarding the importance of sustainability in development. Thank you very much for sparing your time, all of you. Now, today's topic has been chosen by Gujarat and Odisha together, and that is the restoration of heritage and old buildings. Now, you must be wondering, this is a very different kind of a topic being discussed in a sustainability conclave. But we have our own logic for that. See, the reuse and recycle are the most important principles of sustainable development. There is so much emphasis given to recycling of materials and resources in any discussion on sustainability. Here we are promoting the concept of adaptive reuse of heritage buildings, which means recycling or upcycling of not only the materials, but recycling the entire buildings for appropriate modern day use. We in India are fortunate to have a plethora of heritage monuments dating back to the 26th century BC to pre-independence modern heritage. There are hundreds of thousands of heritage monuments and buildings in India, a large number of which are declared as UNESCO World Heritage Sites. Our own walled city of Ahmedabad has also received the coveted World Heritage City status recently. It would be very important to note that most of these heritage buildings are truly sustainable and would confirm to the criteria of green rating agencies such as Leeds, IGBC Griha, and our own GEM, as mentioned by our chairman, Sri Pankaj Dharkar. Conservation of these unique monuments, which lend a unique character to the historic cities and retain the cultural ethos of the community. Their conservation and restoration have all-round benefits. I will list a few benefits, just a few of them. Economic benefits, for example. The restoration of any building is generally cheaper than new construction. It also encourages growth in employment in the restoration industry or the construction trades related to restoration industry, the professionals and manufacturers working in this field of restoration. And most importantly, it promotes and encourages tourism. These are the economic benefits. Then economic sustainability. It creates more local employment than new construction, uses less energy, creates less waste, encourages the enhancement of existing neighborhoods and infrastructure, and opposes a decay or urban sprawl and increased infrastructure cost. energy saving. This is very important. Heritage building conservation is proven to be an energy saver. The energy required to erect a new building is roughly equivalent to the energy required to operate this building for 40 years. So we save a lot of energy by promoting heritage restoration. Less waste, of course, and it is environment friendly. Almost 20 to 25% of the landfill waste is from construction industry, and most of it is due to demolitions. The cost of transportation of debris is significant, and it also causes pollution. So it's a win-win condition if you really undertake these kind of restorations of adapt the old buildings or the heritage buildings for modern day uses. It has been observed that nowadays the global trend is to go for adaptive reuse of these heritage monuments rather than just conserving them or preserving them. Adaptive reuse is defined as the aesthetic process of that adapts buildings for new uses or purposes while retaining their historic features and character. Using an adaptive reuse model can sustainably prolong the building's life by retaining almost all of the building system, including the structure, the shell, and even the interior materials. Some urban planners see adaptive reuse as an effective way of reducing urban sprawl and environmental impact. Revitalizing the existing built fabric by finding a new use or purpose for obsolete buildings can be a wonderful resource to a community by keeping neighborhoods occupied and vital. Traditional building materials and techniques, which have sustained the test of time, have once again become very relevant and appropriate after COVID-19. As they are based on natural light and ventilation. Nowadays, everyone is promoting natural light and ventilation. Friends, I assure you that the session ahead is going to be extremely interesting with the presence of such distinguished speakers and experts, and also blessings from such leading dignitaries. Thank you very much once again for joining. Thank you. Over to you, Shubh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Anantaji. So, dear participants, like here we can see that when we're talking about heritage buildings, we only think about tourism, or we only think about some kind of ancient architect or passive design strategies maximum. But the way architect Anantaji presented, it also gives a lot of other things. Like he said, it's a win-win situation. So maybe it's employment, maybe it's recyclability, green finance, green economy, and environment-friendly things. So there are a lot of things which comes along with it if you look at it broadly. So the theme is completely said properly, sir. Thank you very much for that. So we can move on with our sessions right now. So here, I would like to wait for a while or like pause for a while and would like to give out thanks and support. We are blessed to have support of Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Council of Architecture, NBT India, and NAREDCO. We are thankful to our sustainable partners as well, which are including but not limited to Prince Pipes, Pipings and Fittings, Lubrizol, Panasonic, Mehta Tubes, ALP, Inner Engineering, Daikin Indian, JSW. And we are thankful for all of you without whose support these sessions would not have been possible. So here we'll move on with our special address, Sri Upendranath Beharaji. Harishji, slide please. So we welcome Sri Upendranath Beharaji, IAS, Chairman of the Odisha State Electricity Regulatory Commission, Government of Odisha. We would like to hear from him regarding or the strategies regarding whatever in his mind regarding the restoration of heritage buildings and the theme and beyond. Welcome you, sir. Over to you, please.
Good morning, everybody. Mr. Pankaj Dharka, Chairman of ASSOCHAM GEM. Mr. Anand Trattu, Chairman of Gujarat Chamber of ASSOCHAM GEM. Professor S.S. Rai, Chairman of Odisha Chapter of ASSOCHAM GEM. And all the senior functionaries of ASSOCHAM GEM. I'm really happy to be here with all of you this morning on the occasion of this restoration of heritage buildings in the context of conservation of energy, use of natural resources, less dependence on artificial systems, and more relying more on the natural systems, which our heritage buildings, heritage structures relied on. Let me start with a bit on the problem that is facing today, that is global warming and the global warming that is really staring at us. The problem is extremely serious than is much more serious than many of us could possibly perceive at this moment. Because of the global warming, as you all know, since the Industrial Revolution of mid-18th century till now, there has been an average increase in temperature of 1.5 degrees Celsius all over the world. And the global warming, or the average increase in temperature, the rate of increase in temperature is much more faster now than it ever was. Like for any technology development, you know, the, let's say, computer technology, it started initially slowly, but then it became grew at exponential rate. Unfortunately, this problem of global warming also is increasing at an exponential rate now. Like we took nearly 250 years, nearly 300 years now to increase the temperature by 1.5 degrees Celsius. But the way we are going now, the temperature could increase by 2 degrees Celsius by the turn of this century, which is extremely dangerous actually. And you know, the impact of global warming, the effect of global warming that can have, your ice caps will melt, sea level will rise. There are apprehensions that sea level can rise by 3 to 4 meters in the during this century itself. 3 to 4 meters, you can imagine what will happen to most of the cities, seaside cities, let's say Mumbai, Chennai, many places, Goa, our own in Odisha, Puri, many places. The problem will be very serious if the sea level rises like this. And global warming means it will have effect on many other things. Your whole cropping pattern will change. The whatever crops we are growing at the present level of temperature at a particular place, it will shift. It will shift northwards. The livelihood of the people will change. So, and what is this? Why is this global warming taking place? This is mainly because of the greenhouse gases. There are two major sources of greenhouse gases, that is carbon dioxide and methane. How carbon dioxide, how is it generated? Mostly by burning of fossil fuel, that is coal and petrol, diesel, and all these petroleum oils. So because burning this increases the carbon dioxide. Methane is basically generated from the agriculture waste. And the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has increased by nearly 50% over the last two and a half centuries, as I said, from the Green Revolution. The Industrial Revolution of 1750. From the Industrial Revolution of 1750, by now, the atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide has increased nearly 50%. And atmospheric concentration of methane has increased by nearly 300%, 300 to 400%. These are the two major greenhouse gases. Greenhouse gases absorb heat energy. They absorb more heat energy than they emit. So the temperature, so they will cause global warming. They will cause atmospheric warming, and that is the reason for warming, and that is what is changing our climate. Climate change has many other effects, just not heating, just not warming. You'll have erratic rains, you'll have erratic winds. All this come from the global warming context. And there are methods of reducing these greenhouse gases. For example, first of all, you have to check it. You have to check generating carbon dioxide and methane to some extent. Methane, because agricultural waste cannot be really contained or cannot be really avoided to a certain extent, but then carbon dioxide certainly can be reduced by many measures. If you stop using fossil fuels, that may sound a little radical today, like stop using coal for power generation. 70% of our power generation today is out of coal. We really cannot think of totally scrapping the thermal power plants, coal-based thermal power plants. And we cannot think of depending on diesel and petrol for our transport sector. At this moment, possibly this might look a little absurd, but things are happening. Things are really happening, and it's really happening very soon. And the way renewable energy is growing, it's growing very fast. And in fact, our own country, our own Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister Mr. Modi ji, he gave a very ambitious target of generating 165 gigawatt. That is 175,000 megawatt of renewable energy by 2022. Let me tell you, today our total energy generation, total energy production in the country is something like 300 gigawatt. That is 3 lakh megawatt, and generating 175,000 megawatt of energy from renewable sources is definitely a tall order, but we may fall short by certain this thing, but then we are very close to that nearly. And Honorable Prime Minister has made a further announcement that we'll reach 500 gigawatt of renewable energy by turn of this decade. That is by 2030, we will be generating 5 lakh megawatt of renewable energy. And if we generate 5 lakh megawatt of renewable energy by 2030, we possibly not need any energy from coal-based power plants. And coal-based power plants will be going away soon, if not in 2030. So quite soon it will go away. And that will obviously bring down the carbon dioxide. But then there are other issues also in the electricity sector. So there are efforts in this direction being made to reduce the greenhouse gas. But let us first talk of why electricity? Why this power at all? See, 40% of our electricity is consumed in buildings. 40% of the power is consumed in buildings. We had buildings earlier which did not have power supply. As you said, all these heritage buildings, you're talking about the temples, old buildings, they didn't have electricity at that time. But they used natural lights, they used natural ventilation, they used, they created environment for natural cooling, natural heating. Through all these processes, they did it. And our heritage buildings are, old heritage buildings are testimony to that. You can see many of these buildings, you get inside that building, it's in the worst of summer, they're still cool. Really didn't need air conditioning of those buildings. Many of these structures what we have today. Now the question comes, combining the old heritage with the new technologies. You need air conditioning, you need further cooling. So how can we restore those buildings and also retrofit with modern technologies so that you retain the heritage structures, at the same time you also use modern gadgets, modern equipments which are necessary for our day-to-day. That is also, this is a big challenge for the architects. to, you know, restoration of heritage buildings with again energy efficient techniques. It's really a great challenge, and this is a great challenge for the architects, how to go about it. Things are happening, and I'm sure all the architects, all the people who are present here today, and all the people who are working in this field in the country, they're all working on these areas, and we'll soon see. And heritage building, I don't have to stress on the importance of heritage buildings. It has, besides the, you know, restoring, maintaining these buildings, and as Mr. Tatu said, generating employment for these things. This is a national pride. This is our societal pride. A Taj Mahal, a Konark temple. These are matters of pride for us. This is our cultural heritage. These are national heritage. It's a matter of pride. This actually gives inspiration and encouragement to the youth to think ahead. This is our heritage. This is what we had so many years back, and how can we take it forward? These are inspiration for the youth to kind of function in future. So heritage buildings at any cost need to be protected. A lot of energy and resources are being utilized for restoration and maintenance of these heritage structures. And we have to do that, if not for anything else, at least for our national pride, at least for our cultural heritage. So now coming to, you have spoken about, I would not really like to go much into the, what are the techniques of, you know, energy efficient buildings that, you know, you all know it much better than I do. So that I really need not speak much on that. I'm trying to just give you a broader perspective of the whole problem, broader perspective of how to think for innovative solutions in these areas. But you know it, how you can use natural light, how you can use natural ventilation. Those techniques, you all know it, and this is a part of your curriculum. When you study, these are part of your curriculum, but then ASSOCHAM GEM is taking out a big initiative in certifying those buildings and designs, level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a great thing. This is actually certification gives a recognition. So somebody operates at GEM 5, definitely top of the thing in this area. So he has it's a matter of pride. And these certifications could be incentivized in various ways through regulatory measures also. And this is also possible. I'm sure certain states have given higher fare for this kind of energy saving techniques. So that this is allowing higher fare is definitely a big incentivization. So this can further be incentivized through various regulatory measures. Couple of things, since I am working in the electricity sector, a couple of things I might add here regarding the building design. One area which has not got much attention in our country is rooftop solar energy setups. I have seen in Germany, almost every house has a rooftop solar generation systems. In our country, this has not picked up yet. One reason why it didn't pick up was that solar photovoltaic systems, which is used for electricity generation, used to be expensive. And putting up a 1 kilowatt solar system used to cost, so at one point it was costing more than 5 lakh rupees, 1 kilowatt. Now it has come down to as less as 30,000 to 40,000 rupees only. And it is now. Solar energy, let me tell you, many of you may be having the idea, but solar power plants used to, one unit of solar energy used to cost, one unit is 1 kilowatt hour, one, like you all are familiar with the units because our domestic bills comes in units, number of units consumed. So 1 kilowatt hour energy the cost used to be 15-16 rupees at one point of time, and because of the solar panels became less expensive, we have many situations it has come down to below 3 rupees, even 2.5 rupees, 2.50 rupees. It is cheaper than thermal energy now. Our earlier, in fact, we still have incentivization of renewable energy. Like we have a renewable purchase obligation for those who consume electricity. Like all the electricity distribution companies, they buy electricity and supply to the consumers. There is a renewable purchase obligation for them, that certain percentage of energy they buy has to be renewable energy. But things are changing now. Now, this being the cheapest source of energy, they don't go for any other. This is not an obligation now. This is as a commercial prudence, they go for buying solar energy now. It's a different matter that solar energy has its solar power has its limitation. It has its limitation because you generate it during the day only. You don't, but you need electricity or power during the day, during the night, as well as in the day. And sometimes the requirement in the evening hours is highest during the 24-hour cycle. The evening requirement of energy is much higher. So what do you do? There are various methods of storing energy. Like you can generate solar energy during the daytime when the sun is shining. You can store it and release it. There are methods of storing. The domestic method of storing is by battery storage. You charge the battery when your solar plant is running. You charge the battery and use the battery in the night time for using electricity. Battery also cost used to be high, but again, change in technology. The present day lithium ion batteries have become cheaper, and there are large scale battery plants are coming up. In the household sector, you can certainly have a set of batteries for storing the energy, which can be released during the night time. And in the large scale, this is also going to come, like generation of electricity through coal and or solar. The storing electricity through battery will also be a big business opportunity for the future. It's a big business opportunity. Storing, there could be battery power plants in the sense they will take solar energy, generate solar energy during the daytime, store it, and sell it to the consumer, sell it to the distribution companies during the evening hours. This is going to be a big business opportunity. So, anyway, those are things on a bigger scale. But at the domestic scale, at the household scale, certainly everybody can put up a rooftop solar energy, solar plant for his own use. And another advantage has come now, even the consumer doesn't have to buy his own batteries. All that he can do is he can connect his solar plant to the grid, and he feeds the energy to the grid and takes the energy from the grid. And the distribution companies grid in the evening hours. For that, all regulatory commissions across the country, like Odisha Electricity Regulatory Commission of mine, all the regulatory commissions across the country have got something called net metering arrangement. Net metering is, it's a two-directional meter. So it is your meter, what the household meter that you have got, it can be two-way meter, net metering meter. So you see, you all know the energy can flow both ways. In a circuit, energy can flow from left to right. It can also flow in the same conductor. It can flow from right to left depending on the configuration of the connected load. So here, when you are generating more energy at your home during the daytime, through the net meter it goes out, and during the night it can come. At the end of the day, your meter will be registering what net flow has been there in the 24 hours or in the 1 month or in the 1 year. So suppose you are using today 500 units of electricity for your home, and you generate 200 units during the daytime. So your net energy consumption by your home from the grid is 300 units. To that extent, your bill comes down. And as you know, most states have the billing system where the charges at the low end of the consumption is low and the charges at the higher end of the consumption is high. For example, in Orissa, we have very low rate. We have only 3 rupees per unit for up to 50 units, 50 to 200 units, we have a higher rate. 200 to 400 is still higher. Above 400, the highest rate. Like as I said, up to 50 units, the rate is 50 unit rupees per unit. 3 rupees per unit. And above 4 rupees, 400, above 400 units is more than 5 rupees per unit. So what happens? When your net metering takes place, suppose you are consuming 500 units and you generate 200 or 300 units through solar. So your meter registers only 200 units. So the higher end spectrums are cut down. So in effect, your energy bill comes down to a very low this thing. And in fact, it is very useful to the domestic consumer. And this can actually really be popularized. It has been done. I have seen in Germany, every house has this this thing. And in India also, it can be done. This kind of incentivization is there. And this can be built into this thing. Another area is solar thermal. The solar thermal system is very cheap. Like it is a solar thermal unit of a particular kilowatt can be cheaper than the auto normal geyser we have. The electric geyser that we use in our laboratories, the let's say 10 liter geyser and a 10 liter heating capacity solar thermal system, it can actually cost more or less similar. Whereas you do not need electricity for using that heating that water in the your solar thermal unit that is put up on your roof can provide that energy, and that is almost, I have seen the prices, they are more or less similar. So this is another area where you can, where things can be used. So now these are all energy requirements. Now come to the crux of the thing, that is, do we really need energy? And that is where your work comes. You may not really need energy for the household application. Many of it can be cut out by efficient, energy efficient designs. And I'm sure people, all of you are working in that direction, and you can make a big contribution to the national objective of reducing the greenhouse gases, national objective of home. And let me tell you one more thing. Earlier, we used to say electricity consumption is a measure of the economic development. Higher the per capita electricity consumption of a country, higher is the level of economic development of that. But also it is true, like electricity consumption in USA is nearly 10 times that of average electricity consumption in a household in US is nearly 10 times that of India. And they are very developed, we are not so developed. But there has been a lot of studies conducted on this. Like while there is a correlation between the electricity per capita electricity consumption and the per capita GDP of countries, there is something called a causality effect. A lot of causality studies has been done, whether electricity consumption gives rise to economic development or economic development gives rise to electricity consumption. This is a very interesting study. In fact, there has been seen two-way causalities in this, and there has been seen one-way causalities in this. So most countries, particularly developing countries, the sign is more the economic, the faster the economy is growing, faster does the electricity consumption grow. While some have two-way causalities, but developed countries have shown that your this causality is in the other direction. In the developing countries, it is more the electricity consumption, more will be the economic development. That is causality from electricity consumption to economic. Most developed countries, the causality is in the other direction. More the development, more is the electricity consumption. That doesn't mean that less electricity consumption gives rise to less dump. No. How? Less electricity, their electricity consumption is actually reducing now every year, while economic development is increasing. So your per capita income is increasing. That is because they have taken so much electricity consumption, conservation measures. This is called conservation principle. They have taken so much of conservation principles. Conservation principle can be many ways, as I told you. The most important of it is efficient building design. So while their electricity consumption is coming down, the economic development is picking up. So this is a very robust study. In fact, many studies have been done across the world over the last 30-40 years on this subject, and this is seen that in the developed countries, causality is in this direction. Rather, that if you reduce your electricity consumption through conservation measures, it really doesn't bring down your economic development. It increases your economic development nonetheless. So, with this, I would hope that this seminar will be a great success. And with more and more people joining this GEM certification program, you can really do a big service to the nation by way of energy conservation and reduction in global warming. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. That's really intuitive. Like you started like from global warming effect and how these greenhouse gases are causing a lot of casualties and how we can really decrease it in terms of carbon dioxide or methane and how the rich heritage buildings, they didn't use any kind of energy and how we can also go to that extent by making kind of energy efficient design buildings right now as well, contemporary, and it has nothing to do with economy. Even the economy can grow even if you can save energy, if you make energy conservation measures. And we have a lot to do, lot to imbibe, lot to understand from the rich heritage buildings, which is the theme of the topic today, restoration of heritage buildings as such. So thank you, sir, for that illuminating thoughts. And one thing that I would like also to mention that the green buildings, the Asochem GEM Green Building Program, you are talking about incentives and you are talking about a lot of solar models and everything. So I think Asochem GEM Green Building Certifications Program can also be a kind of way forward with OERC that we can develop with the approach, the how we can be like energy efficient model and energy efficient rating system or something, if you allow us some time later. I think that thing we can do, right?
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, thank you very much. So we would move forward with the sessions. So Sri Punnes Modi ji, our guest of honor, Honorable Minister for Road and Building, Transport, Civil Aviation, Tourism and Pilgrimage Development, Government of Gujarat. And he could not be here, but he sent a very beautiful message. I would like to invite Lokendra ji, architect Lokendra Balsaria ji, to read out the message and give out the blessing, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, if you can keep your phone nearby, we cannot hear you. So it's a little bit.
Sorry. Now can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you right now. Yes.
Okay. उन्होंने एक बहुत सुंदर मैसेज भेजा है हम सबके लिए, तो I am honored to read it out on behalf of श्री पुर्नेश जी. उनका लेटर पढ़ रहा हूँ. एसओचेम मंगलवार 30 नवंबर से 2 दिसंबर 2021 वर्चुअल और शुक्रवार 3 दिसंबर से 4 दिसंबर इंडियन हैबिटेट सेंटर नई दिल्ली में जैम फोर्थ इंटरनेशनल सस्टेनेबिलिटी कॉन्क्लेव और एक्सपो का आयोजन कर रहा है. आज का वर्चुअल सेशन गुजरात और ओडिशा द्वारा संयुक्त रूप से आयोजित किया जा रहा है. एक साथ आना और जलवायु परिवर्तन, पर्यावरण और संबंधित चुनौतियों का मुकाबला करने की दिशा में काम करना एक अद्भुत बात है. एसओचेम जैम सही दिशा में है. मुझे विरासत की बहाली विषय पसंद आया. यह सच है कि हमारे पास एक महान विरासत है और सभी प्राचीन मंदिरों, इमारतों, महलों और नगर नियोजन के ढांचे को बहुत सावधानी से तैयार किया गया था. एक स्थायी राष्ट्र बनाने के बारे में सोचते समय हमें ऐसे उदाहरणों से सीखने की जरूरत है. आयोजन और एक्सपो के लिए मेरी शुभकामनाएं. कुछ वैश्विक बैठक के कारण मैं वर्चुअल सत्र में शामिल नहीं हो सका। हालांकि एसोचैम जैम, ग्रीन बिल्डिंग काउंसिल और इसकी पहलों को मेरी शुभकामना जो प्रधानमंत्री जी के विजन के अनुरूप है। मेरी तरफ से एसोचैम और एसोचैम जैम गुजरात चैप्टर को शुभकामनाएं। धन्यवाद। आपको अनम्यूट करना पड़ेगा।
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू फॉर दैट इल्यूमिनेटिंग थॉट एंड ये मैसेज बहुत अच्छा लगा सर। सो हमको बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद हम करते हैं सर जी को। एंड एक्चुअली हम लोग ट्राई करेंगे और ट्राई क्यों हम करते रहेंगे, वी विल ट्राई टू मूव फॉरवर्ड, वी विल ट्राई टू मूव व्हाट आर द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स, व्हाट आर द विजन्स, व्हाट आर द इनिशिएटिव्स आर देयर ऑफ एसोसिएशन जेम। We'll try to implement it every time, and every time we'll move forward with this kind of thing. And restoration of heritage buildings, ये एक ऐसा theme है जिसके ऊपर बहुत सारे ways में develop किया जा सकता है। Maybe it is tourism, maybe it is economy, maybe it is like energy and efficiency and anything, lot of things that were explored before today. So before, thank you Lokendra ji for reading that out for us. Thank you very much. Yes, sir. Sir, we'll move forward for with our next session. So before that. Would like to play our sincere gratitude to our gold platinum Mehta Tubes. So we'd like to play some small video of Mehta Tubes. Harish ji, can you please play the video? Harish ji, video please. I think there is some technical glitch, so we'll figure it out. Meanwhile, we'll go to our move sessions. Professor S.S. Rai, our industry speaker for today. So we'd like to invite Professor S.S. Rai, the chairman of Asocham JM Odisha chapter, director of School of Architecture and Planning, KIT University. Can you please show the slide, please, Harish ji? Welcome, sir. So we'd like to hear from you a lot of things regarding restoration of heritage buildings, because I am from Odisha, so it's great to understand a lot of things in terms of architecture, in terms of how we can rebuild this our entire economy or do something in this building industry, learning from the heritage buildings. So we'd like to hear from you, sir. Over to you.
Let's see the best setting option.
Good morning. Can I have my visual sharing options?
What is your share options, please? You have it, sir.
Very distinguished guest today, Sri Upendranath Behra ji, Chairman Odisha State Electric Regulatory Commission, Sri Pankaj Dharkar ji, Anand Tattu ji, the chairman of Gujarat chapter. I am glad that we are talking about the restoration of heritage buildings today, which is a topic which is very relevant to Odisha and Gujarat as well. Upendra Behra ji, on his remarks, made a very wonderful remark. The remark was combining heritage with technology, which is the need of the hour. I'm trying to talk about a topic, how our cities are split in terms of aesthetics, how our cities are split in terms of expressions and life. I live in old town of Bhubaneswar. And I live, which is at a house which is 2 kilometers away from Lingaraj temple. It is about same distance from Mukteswar temple and Bindusagar water tank. I work in KIT University, which is a part of new development. When I travel every morning, I find the architecture, the city's expression, city's identity is broken, and there is a disconnectivity. I would like to find that we live in our cities in different layers. I would like to address and bring to this learned gathering the issues I feel, my personal understanding of the places we go through every day. So I start with a very opening remark. Cultural heritage is one of the biggest magnets for cities to attract visitors from all over the world. If someone is coming to Bhubaneswar, he is trying to definitely come for Lingaraj temple, not for the modern buildings we create. So if we do not have a Kamarakshetra heritage and old town, the temple city as we know, we lose our identity, which was highlighted by our honorable guest Punas Modi ji on his message. So I start with a small sketch. The sketch is, we call it as a Obolkora. Obolkora is a boy who doesn't want to listen. He is little naughty. And he is in this sketch, he is traveling with his guru. So guru is a learned person. And what happens in this sketch is when he is traveling with the guru, he is asking him very interesting questions. And guru says, Pakka kamal po chata sun abalkara kohuchi khata. So this is in Odia, which means please spread your blanket, open your umbrella, settle down. And he tries to explain the questions put forth by the naughty boy, and learned answers, then travels. And when they finish the discussions, they travel again. And when they travel again, Obolkora puts another question. So my idea of telling this is storytelling and questioning and traveling are the part of our heritage. And through storytelling, we have unfolded the history throughout. We have unfolded the heritage throughout. All our narrations have been like this. So my presentation will be on a short storytelling of our heritage and our history, so far as Bhubaneswar is concerned and Odisha is concerned. We know we are 480 kilometers of coastal stretch, which is quite long in Bay of Bengal. And if we look into our coastal stretch and look into the Odisha, we have various types of architectural heritage. We have a huge lot of Adivasis with wonderful, colorful houses. We had Buddhism and Jain vestiges. Odisha is known for classical and eclectic world-class temples. A lot of palaces are there. Forts are there. There are a lot of art and craft villages. We had a colonial traces. They built some beautiful colleges, beautiful buildings, magnificent buildings, Ravensa College and so on. And we have early modern imprints and also contemporary expressions, good or bad, the architects like us, which are adding. So if we look into the state's identity is very rich. State is described as a poetry in stone. We have wonderful stone forts, Syrian houses, eclectic palaces. We had grand universities, Lalitgiri, Pushpagiri, and so more. Technofreak buildings, contemporary. We have richly decorated earthen homes expressed by our villages, also by tribals. We have a lot of timber palaces. We are known for calling the style of architecture. Postmodern campuses now being built. We are very bright, colorful. So we are known for extravaganza in terms of color. A lot of brick churches, austere monasteries, monochrome homes. If you look into this sort of a diversity that has, I think this is a state which needs restoration, which needs calls for good heritage thinking. This is a proud statement for any state. If we go back to our history, You see, 3,000 years we had Adivasis. Then we had a Kalinga war where Ashoka fought a bloody war, and we had Dhauli and Jogoda edicts, and where he spread Buddhism. We have the three great religions, Buddhism, Jainism, Hinduism, spread over here. We had the flowering of Kalinga style architecture at this place. World-class monuments, Lingaraj, Jagannath, and Konark temples. Kalinga style matured here. We have temples which were described as Natyamandap, Bhogmandap, Amlaka, Nagarka, Pidhadela, Sikhara, etc. The styles that generated from these areas. Then we had strategic defense colonies, colonial buildings, and early modern buildings. And as we are on the aesthetic trajectory since 1970s, buildings which are contemporary and modern, and they are also sometimes influenced by West and things like that. So this is a book on which I worked out the cover page, search, worked on the environment along the Bindusagar water tank. So I put this sketch to see how Odisha used to look, or Bhubaneswar used to look during that period. This is just a potter style painting to show that. So if this is our background, so I can say if India lives in several centuries, in that notion, Bhubaneswar lives in many millennia. So this is a very proud statement, but it's a statement of diversity. It's a statement of purity. It's a statement of plurality that represents Odisha and Bhubaneswar. So history is over 2000 years. It's an ancient capital of Kalinga. It has the identity is known as the city of temples. It is named after three Bhubaneswar, lords of three worlds, and preserves more than 500 India's finest temples. Look at the proud, you know, identity that the city possesses. It has a mythological reference to Ekamara Khetra and known as a Saiva Pitha of the world. Now, let me go back to my topic and talk about the layers. When we talk about layers of life, the best example I find is the onion, which is, you can peel the onion and find the different layers, what its core is different and its surface is different. So once, let us now peel the onion layer by layer. So this is, I'm trying to peel it, onion. So we have a 4th century BC Shishupal god, fortified Shishupal, which is our core. We have 3rd century Jain and Buddhist settlements, Khandagiri and Udagiri caps. We have 7th to 13th century Ekamara Khetra, that's in a, slowly I'm coming to outer layers. Then Mughal raid in 15th century. 20th century, Bhubaneswar declares new capital, replacing Cuttack. So these are the some pictures of 3rd century BC and 2nd century, Khandagiri, Udagiri, Ashokan edicts, Shishupal god. These are, we are coming to 7th and 8th centuries. So we have the temples, and it's a city of temples, Lingaraj, Rajarani, Baital temple, and they're very diverse in taste and richness and quality of architecture. This is pre-modern where Julius Vyas worked here. And these are the temples. He's an architect who tried to take temples and the traditional features into contemporary expressions. So on the top, we see his drawings of Rabindra Mandap, which inherits its inspiration from Buddhist Biharas, and a capital police station, which inspires from a temple and a market building as well. These are some contemporary buildings we are trying to do. So these are the, all these 5-6 buildings have been designed by me, but that is irrelevant. But this is what is the expressions that are coming in a contemporary canvas. So if you look into a single canvas, single visual, so we had a wonderful, if you look at the top, we have the temple, which was dominating the aesthetics, the skyline, and the below is the you have the remains of Dhauli and all that places, Jain vestiges. But if you go back to the last visuals, the columns you see on the right are the Shishupal God. But if you go to the you see the urban mess, history less, geography less, concrete jungles being added every day by day. This is what is trying to slowly a decline of aesthetic expressions. So let us talk about historical backgrounds. So we had Ashokan edicts, rise of Kharabhala, birth of Jainism. We had Shishupal God, rise of Shivaism. Odisha became got ruled by Afghans, then became a part of Bengal Madras. Then Odisha became free and it became the capital of Odisha. And the most important part is Otto Koensberger came to Odisha to spearhead the planning process. So I'm slowly shifting to the contemporary. If you look into the physical characteristics, it's in the coastal plain of Odisha. It's strategically located between Katak and Puri. Healthy, dry, salubrious soil, and ground sloping from east to west, natural drainage. So it's a very wonderful thing for doing a very beautiful new town. Laterite, plenty of laterites in sandstone. Topography is very wonderful. And Daya River runs with a lot of tributaries and a part of Delhi. So this is such a wonderful drainage system that naturally existed. But what happened is when we designed the city, we designed for 20,000 people. Koensberger started designing. He was asked to design for that. But Koensberger wanted a city which is much more in terms of with a scope of unlimited expansion, and to organize the town in such a manner that it forms an organizing and healthy structure at each stage of its development. But unfortunately, it didn't happen. It got designed because people will prefer to live in Katak and work here. So it was designed for a service class city. So I'm not going detail into it. So he wanted to extend it much bigger, much larger, with a huge scope of growth. But and he wanted to include Old Town in the planning process in order to avoid haphazard construction and intensifying the land speculations. So wherever he faced a lot of reluctance in the bureaucracy, and somehow it didn't happen. So time is short to elaborate on these issues. This is a sketch which shows the contours. If you see this wonderful contours, and out of which a limited area was chosen for the top end, which we have, we call it Koensbergian Bajarian Bhubaneswar. And he worked on very nice neighborhood units. We call it unit one, unit two. And the specialty of a unit was it must be maximum 1.1 square kilometers so that people can walk, and they walk up to the main, vehicular trail, so that you don't waste time. And there are self-sufficient units in terms of which the school dispensary put into this. But unfortunately, in the current growth, we don't have. These are the wonderful units he designed. These are some of his unit plans, which is a clustered open space, nicely regulated. And it was a very, very climate sensitive layout. And when I came 30 years back to Bhubaneswar, we used to have so much of good breeze every afternoon. And the orientation and site planning was very energy efficient, etc. But there was a debate what should be the architectural character. I'm coming to plan from planning to architecture characters. And we got a very, very fabulous architect from, he was a fresh graduate from JJ School of Architecture by the name of Julius Bass. He was working in Gregson Bentley King. He was the boss of what was the first government architect. Julius Bass wanted to build Odisha in terms of temple-inspired architecture. So the buildings you do should have its own origin, one identity, and it should not be very modern, nice buildings. So these are the some of the craft villages we have all around, like Raghurajpur, etc. And the Raghurajpur people are so sensitive. These are the what you call time and activity map of the village sketched all around the walls of the village. And unfortunately, Quensburger and the planner and the architect had a conflict in terms of architectural expressions. And Quensburger wanted it to be a very modern city with rectangular grid pattern. Julius Vass wanted it to be inspired by what you call Indian villages or Odisha architectural ethos has to be there. It should have a lot of verandas, lounges, but like that we build in Odisha architecture. So anyway, there was confusion, but the confusion also had a lot of good things. There was healthy debate. And Governor Asif Ali came and overruled the architecture of new capital should transform to the ancient art of Odisha. These are some of Julius Vass' work, which talks about the temple architecture and inspirations. This is Rabindra Mandap, which is connects to the Buddhist architectural inspirations. These are how the Odisha Museum built those days. Had a lot of, you know, concern about the climate and the north light brought into the houses, the secretariat and temple. The police station also draws inspiration from Odisha temples. And this is a market building, which is also inspired by Odisha temples. So he tried to create a wonderful contemporary conservation technique and expressing the new buildings. And so this is now, let us come to the fresh layers. So fresh layer is Bhubaneswar is a prominent city in the Chennai and China coast. It's a gate to Southeast Asia. Buddhism started from here and did spread all over the Asia. And this is how the Buddhism came. It is a very interesting story. Two businessmen went to Bodh Gaya from Kalinga, sought blessings of Lord Buddha. Buddha in return gave him a hair. They served some food to Lord Buddha. And they came back and they wanted to preserve the hair. So they built a stupa and built it. That is how the stupa architecture came and became prominent to India and this part of the world. So also we are very connected to Southeast Asia. And if we see buildings around us, the nearer cities, Myanmar, Laos, Kerala, they have a very, very distinct architectural identity if you talk about a bigger region of Southeast Asia. These are the bigger region of Southeast Asia and their architectural styles all around. This is a study we did. We divided the 480 kilometers of coastal stretch into four distinct parts, and we tried to find out the architecture is very different. So far as people build what you call is a vernacular styles. And so my question is, so can, now my question comes, can modern architecture coexist with traditional architecture? Can our temples have a place in terms of architecture imagery? So I suggest this contemporary is not a style. It's an attitude towards a style. And if you want to have a contemporary expression of traditionally rich Odisha, one could probably do in two ways. So one could try with traditional material with modern tactics, or modern material with traditional techniques. So these are the some of my buildings and experiments where I have tried to draw. These are the Baleswar houses which I have represented in a new modern school. And the traditional vernacular architecture finds a expression in a contemporary way. So this is how our Santals build, our tribal community build. So this is became an inspiration for me. These are the Godaba villages when I built a school for Adani group. So those triangular aesthetics became an answer to the contemporary buildings. This is my own studio, which is the first five-star rated green building of Odisha, which draws a lot of inspiration from old town, what is and local work and local architecture get a lot of scope to get placed there. So they can be very much bolded, because building is the best place to create traditional art and craft and save them and use them effectively. So these are some of the visuals of my own studio where you can create potter paintings. So these are the lions, because knowledge is power, on a discussion table. So these are how the temple scriptures, architecture, the styles can be incorporated in a contemporary fashion. I talked about four layers. Now I'm going to conclude. So if we look into the layer one, Bhubaneswar used to look like this with Shishupal Garh as its center. Layer two is Bhubaneswar as a Kamar Khetra. This is what was to be the skyline. Layer three is Julius Vaz and Koenigsberger type period. Bhubaneswar as a capital city, say about 60 years. And now this is what we're trying to build today. So my question is, I'm putting all the four layers together. And my question is appropriate layer. What is the right appropriate layer? So I'm not one to decide the appropriate layer. So ladies and gentlemen, it is your decision what should be the modern representation of Bhubaneswar should be. Cultural heritage are fundamental aspects of our identity and must be transferred to the next generation in the best possible conditions. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Over to you, Sub.
Thank you, sir. So what should be the appropriate layer? Yeah, that's the question. I mean, I think that will take some time to answer, maybe, and especially in the young architects and the young minds. And that is the appropriate questions. And contemporary is not really an architect type. It is an attitude, and that's attitude we can develop amongst ourselves. What should be the appropriate attitude? Thank you very much, sir. That's a great one. Bhubaneswar, I even did not know a lot of things about it, and we all got illuminated by such beauty of cities, beauty of architecture, modern contemporary, and the olden times, the ancient times, restoration of heritage buildings that we are calling it. And now the themes of smart cities are coming up, and we would like to get some insight from you during the audience interactions later, so that we can have insight from you and our next speaker, Lokendraji, about a lot of other things. So here we'd move forward with our next industry speaker, architect Lokendra Balsariaji, co-chairman Association GEM Gujarat chapter, founder Tree Works, and director Second Alliance Foundation's partner, Las Peggio. So we'd like to hear from you, sir, like regarding the Gujarat, what are the conditions and how you'd like to collaborate it, what should be the way forward in terms of restorations of heritage buildings, how you see it. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shiva. Thank you. Can you hear me clearly?
Yeah, I can hear you. We all can hear you. Yes, thank you.
See, today I'll be talking from a little different perspective. I'm basically an architect and urban planner. And for the last one decade, we've been working on ecological issues and trying to reconnect with nature, you know, because we realize that as architects, as urban people, we are largely disconnected from ecology. So that's what my role has been. We are talking about heritage building, restoration of heritage building, which is also called adaptive reuse. Very interesting thing. Bahut simple bhasha mein bole to modify and reuse. And this modify and reuse is nothing very old for us. It's a very old concept with all of us. Like old clothes, you know. Ki purani chaddar mein se thele bante the, aur thele ke baad mein poche ka kapda banta tha. Thikani jata tha. Today, when we look at pollution globally, probably textile garments are one of the biggest pollutants. There are mountains which are full of old clothes. So this was something which was very common to our thing. When you restore and reuse an old building, there is low disruption. you break less, there is low mobilization, and the most important is there is low wastage. Kachra bahut kam hota hai because we don't break the building. So this is a very interesting concept which probably should be looked as a philosophy really. And why I'm looking at it as philosophy is when you do a restoration of a building, the building adjusts a bit and we adjust a bit. Jo occupier hota na wo bhi thoda adjust hota hai, building bhi thodi adjust ho jati hai, and hum kahin beech mein jaake milte hain. And nature ke sath actually wo hi karna chahiye, and that's where the balance is. If you achieve that balance, I think ecologically it will be much easier to make our ecology more balanced, more healthy, less problematic, etc. Let's look at some of these issues which I'm talking about. When we look at heritage buildings, you know, there are certain distinct advantages heritage buildings had. Now they had because of understanding or because of lack of technology. Dono cheez the, aisa nahi the ki keval samajhdari the, but technology bhi bahut kam thi. Like I'll give an example of Ahmedabad, the old city the last 400 years never got flooded. But naye shehar mein to almost every rainy season there is flooding. When you look at the reasons, you realize that probably the old city respected the contours, the slopes. GCBs or bade bade earth moving machines nahi the, so the slopes were maintained like that. So basically nature was respected for what it was. So when we look at heritage building, they respected nature. Now because of lack of it, lack of technology or a better understanding, whatever it was, but the bottom line is they respected ecology. They were reasonably self-sufficient as far as possible. So again, probably because of lack of electricity, lack of technology, har ek room ko comfortable banana tha, light lani thi, courtyard lana tha, pani ka tanka bhi niche banana tha ki barish ka pani wahin pe ruk jaye. So they were quite self-sufficient in many ways, and that also made them quite comfortable. Today's buildings are not as comfortable because we have the comfort of technology available. कोई नहीं यहाँ पे लाइट लगा देंगे, यहाँ पे दो एसी लगा देंगे, विच ओल्ड बिल्डिंग्स डिन हैव, सो दे वर क्वाइट कंफर्टेबल एंड दे वर आल्सो मच लॉन्ग ड्यूरेशन सर्वाइवल वाले. सो ओल्ड बिल्डिंग्स दे लिव्ड मच लॉन्गर बिकॉज ऑफ द मटीरियल, बिकॉज ऑफ दे वर कंस्ट्रक्टिंग. लाइक वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट टाटूजी वन प्रोजेक्ट विच इज डूइंग इन पोरबंदर, ही सेज वेरी नाइसली दिस पैलेस इज 150 ईयर्स ओल्ड and they are redoing it in traditional ways. So wohi chuna, wohi lakde ko bel tel mein dal ke karne ka, you know, all those things they are doing, and he is saying that this building would last another 100 years. So aap sochiye wo building 250 saal jeene wali hai. Concrete ki life keval 60 saal ki rahi jati hai, nayi buildings 250 saal nahi jeene wali hai. To jo apne paas aisa saman hai jo बहुत लंबी आयुष्य वाला है, विच रिस्पेक्ट नेचर, विच इज सेल्फ सफिशियंट, वाई ब्रेक इट, वाई नॉट री यूज इट, इट मेक्स इकोलॉजिकल सेंस. एंड लास्ट पॉइंट, ऑल दिस बिल्डिंग्स हैड मोर और लेस नेचुरल मटीरियल्स, दे डिडंट हैव सिंथेटिक मटीरियल. आई विल टेल यू अ स्मॉल एग्जांपल. वी वर वर्किंग ऑन अ स्कूल प्रोजेक्ट which was a modern building with concrete and cement and acrylic paint and, you know, synthetic tiles and everything. And the clients asked me, when can we do the plantation? So we told them, you have to finish the building, finish the color work, wash the building clean of whatever. After that, the top 3-inch layer of the soil will be removed and then plantation will happen. And we realized, my God, everything is toxic in this building. All building materials are toxic material. मतलब इतना बुरा material है हम use कर रहे हैं आजकल कि जब building खत्म होती है तो soil की top 3-inch layer निकाल के फेंक देनी पड़ती है, because उसमें पौधे भी नहीं उगने वाले. जबकि old buildings had all natural materials, stone, things like that. So old buildings had lot of advantages. So why not use those advantages, build on that, relocate? See, I'm not looking at restoration of heritage building just as a one singular act. I'm looking as an attitude, as an approach. When you try to restore heritage buildings and reuse them, you are developing an attitude also. And this attitude got disrupted with the Industrial Revolution. When Industrial Revolution happened, now we started producing very fast. We started making so many things, and we thought that energy, petroleum energy was unlimited. We thought natural resources were unlimited. लगा कि जमीन के नीचे से पानी हमेशा निकलता रहेगा, लगता रहा कि जंगल से लकड़ी हमेशा आती रहेगी, रॉ मटेरियल आता रहेगा. एंड इंडस्ट्री बिकेम सो इम्पॉर्टेंट दैट अ होल न्यू फील्ड ऑफ एजुकेशन एमर्ज कॉल्ड मैनेजमेंट. सो वी ऑल स्टार्टेड टीचिंग एंड लर्निंग टेक्निक्स टू सपोर्ट इंडस्ट्री एंड इम्प्रूव प्रोडक्शन. हुआ क्या, got into the concept of disposable. So you do use disposable, you make disposable, so the economy and the industry survives. So the problem is with the disposable, you know. So the plastic bag is not very bad because plastic came into being about 150 years back, but it became a problem in the last 3-4 decades. Why? Because we started disposing things. Similarly, so when we start looking at disposing buildings, we are working on the same philosophy, which is not eco-friendly. So let's look at this whole approach, change this whole approach of going to reusing things. Even in ecology, we're talking of reuse as a very important, you know, component of making things sustainable in cities. So probably buildings are the most important tool, probably the biggest product that we have, which needs to be recycled and reused. Now that's my concept. So I don't want to get into nitty-gritty of restoration of heritage building, because there are a lot of things, and I'm sure most of the people attending know those nitty-gritty. A lot of people have talked about it very nicely. You know, people have talked about the components of culture, heritage, the values of history. Now, they have talked of very nice, important components. So I don't want to get into that. I'm just talking about it as an ecological model. You have to reuse the building. You have to modify the building. And I think that's the correct approach, really. So that's all for my side. I don't want to extend it too much because I think we are already shooting beyond that time we had planned for. So Shubh, over to you. Thank you so much. And this is what I might talk about. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Lokendraji. That perspective is really, really great. So we'll have an audience interaction session. So we'll have questions. There are certain questions in my mind as well. I'm getting some questions from audience from the question and answer session as well privately. So I'll answer Sutu's questions right away in a few minutes. Before that, I would like to make a presentation, like a video presentation of Mehta Tubes, our gold platinum. The video was not available that time. Right now we can play it, Harishji. Then we'll go to the audience sections, audience interaction sections. Thank you, Harish. So here we move to our next session, which is audience interactions. So we have few questions. So yahan pe sir, hum apni will speak our heart out today because we are talking about our restoration. So we are talking about our identities throughout. सर लोकेंद्र जी आपके लिए ये क्वेश्चन है कि वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट मेटेरियल रीयूज, वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट बिल्डिंग रीयूज, सो यहाँ पे हाउ मच इट इज फिजिबल राइट नाउ विद द काइंड ऑफ एटीट्यूड, लोगों का जिस तरह से एटीट्यूड है बिल्डिंग रीयूज करना वर्सेस नया करना, इन टर्म्स ऑफ कॉस्टिंग, इन टर्म्स ऑफ लुक्स, इन टर्म्स ऑफ दैट हाइट बी लॉट ऑफ रिनोवेशन दैट माइट बी पॉसिबल. सो यहाँ पे सर आपके लिए सर दो क्वेश्चन मेरे यहाँ पे आया है. एक चीज है कि व्हेन यू आर डिफाइनिंग अबाउट हेरिटेज बिल्डिंग्स, हाउ व्हाट यू कंसिडर एज हेरिटेज बिल्डिंग्स, क्योंकि कभी कभी हमने ऐसा देखा है बहुत सारे बिल्डिंग्स जो 100 ईयर्स पहले है, जैसे आई हैव सीन सम फ्यू इन कलकत्ता, आई मीन दे आर लाइक ब्रेकिंग, आई मीन देर द थिंग्स आर ब्रेकिंग एंड इट डजंट लुक दैट गुड, सो पीपल डोंट लाइक टू इन्वेस्ट मच दैट, इंस्टेड दे वांट टू डेमोलिश दैट और वहाँ पे कुछ नया बनाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं. तो हम लोग जब बिल्डिंग रीयूज कर रहे हैं तो कितना मतलब माइंडसेट लोगों का कैसा रहता है और कैन यू डू इट रियली, and second is what is the definition of heritage building in this sense?
But there are two understand that all are talking about ecological challenges right now, but wo ecological challenge kya hai wo samajhna zaruri hai.
Is tarah aawaz thoda aapka
sir, main ek bahut simple example de raha hu aapko. Dinosaurs prithvi pe 17 million years the, मतलब 170 लाख साल पृथ्वी पर थे. हम ह्यूमन बींग्स को तो बंदर से अभी तक बनने में 5 लाख साल ही हुए हैं और अपन ऑलरेडी बात कर रहे हैं कि शायद ह्यूमन रेस एक्सटिंक्ट हो जाएगी. तो आप मैग्नीट्यूड समझिए बात का. कोविड में 50 लाख लोग मरे थे, एयर पॉल्यूशन से 70 लाख लोग हर साल मर रहे हैं. ये एनवायरमेंटल इश्यूज हैं. अहमदाबाद में 20 साल पहले बहुत बड़े बड़े हॉस्पिटल नहीं थे, अभी बहुत बड़े बड़े हॉस्पिटल बन रहे हैं और वो सारे ओवरलोडेड हैं. कैंसर जो 10 साल पहले था उससे आज 5 गुना ज्यादा है. ये इश्यू समझने पड़ेंगे तब जाके हम रियल एनवायरमेंटल एक्शन को समझेंगे और लेंगे. अधूरी समझ से हम कोई डिसीजन नहीं लेना चाहिए और ना ले पाएंगे. सो व्हाट वी बीन टॉकिंग एट गुजरात चैप्टर इज दैट द टाइम हैज कम फॉर एवरी चाइल्ड, एवरी वुमेन, एवरी मैन, एवरीवन टू डू सम पॉजिटिव एनवायरमेंटल एक्शन. अदरवाइज ये जो 70 लाख साल और 5 लाख साल का जो कंपैरिजन है ना, वो वहीं पे रह जाएगा. सो ये अगर बात समझ जाएंगे ना, देन कंजर्विंग, बीइंग एनवायरमेंटल फ्रेंडली विल बिकम मीनिंगफुल एंड सेंसिबल एंड लोग समझेंगे, अदरवाइज दे विल बिकम एकेडमिक डिस्कशंस. तो वो करेंगे फिर लोग अपने आप बोलेंगे हाँ भाई मुझे नहीं तोड़ना, मैं यूज करूंगा, मैं थोड़ा मॉडिफाई कर लूंगा, चलेगा, बट कोई बात नहीं, ये कपड़ा नहीं फेंकूंगा. सो वी नीड टू डू दैट. वी हैव डन दिस एक्सरसाइज विद स्कूल चिल्ड्रन. हम उनको अहमदाबाद के कचरे के माउंटेन पे लेके गए हैं ये दिखाने की अहमदाबाद का सबसे ऊंचा पहाड़ कचरे का बना हुआ है. एंड दे चेंज द स्कूल, चेंज दे आर वर्किंग दे आर अप्रोच, यू नो. सो वी नीड टू डू दिस एक्सपोजर एंड थिंग्स विल चेंज, दैट्स वन पार्ट. हेरिटेज बिल्डिंग किसको बोलते हैं? बहुत ही डिफिकल्ट क्वेश्चन है, उसका एक ब्लैंकेट आंसर नहीं हो सकता. वील हैव टू डिसाइड फ्रॉम केस टू केस. Because see, nothing survives forever. Everything dies, everything gets destroyed. So when we have a building, we have to look at it and we have to do a logical, sensible understanding whether it's worth retaining and repairing or whether it should be broken away. Krishna ji ki dwarka abhi nahi hai apne paas mein, hai na? Bhagwan ka bana hua jab shahar hi nahi raha. So let's is understand ki everything dies someday. So there can't be any blanket decisions. There can be guidelines. There can be indicative guidelines. Ki itne saal ki ho to retain hona chahiye. Itna cultural value hai to retain karna chahiye. Jaise Ahmedabad mein we are looking at heritage trees. We are saying agar ped 50 saal purana hai, या हिस्टोरिकल सिग्निफिकेंस तो रखें, वैसे बिल्डिंग्स का कर सकते हैं, ठीक है। सो आई थिंक दिस इज माई आंसर टू दिस टू पॉइंट्स, होप आई हैव बीन एबल टू क्लैरिफाई।
जी सर, ये है कि मतलब हेरिटेज बिल्डिंग वी कैन नॉट पुट अ ब्लैंकेट टर्म डेफिनेशन फॉर दैट, ये पर्सपेक्टिव भी आप लॉजिक की बात करते हैं कि जस्ट लुकिंग एट दैट बिल्डिंग विल अंडरस्टैंड कि इसको रखना है, रिटर्न करना है कि डेमोलिश करना, कौन सा वाइजर होगा। बट अगर हम रखते हैं तो जनरली वो ऐसे बिल्डिंग्स होते हैं जो बहुत बहुत साल सर्वाइव किए हैं थ्रू आउट एवरीथिंग, एंड उसमें नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज जनरली ज्यादा यूज होते हैं देन दिस इज कॉन्क्रीट एंड कॉन्क्रीट जंगल मेकिंग द कॉन्क्रीट जंगल, बिकॉज लॉट ऑफ क्लेज एंड लाइक थिंग्स द नेचुरल थिंग्स दैट यू सेड आर बीइंग यूज्ड इन इट। सो इसको डेमोलिश करते हैं तो भी टॉप टॉप लेयर ज्यादा डिस्टर्ब नहीं होता कंपैरेटिवली तो डेमोलिशंस नाउडेज, ये भी एक बात है। तो जो आपने बहुत अच्छी तरीके से बोला कि लैक ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी समटाइम्स फोर्सेस अस टू गो टुवर्ड्स नेचर, गो टुवर्ड्स इंटेलेक्ट, ये बहुत ही अच्छी बात कही सर, बहुत बहुत थैंक यू। और मैं अभी राय सर से बात करना पूछना चाहूंगा कि वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट स्मार्ट सिटी एंड भुवनेश्वर इज ऑल्सो अ स्मार्ट सिटी, वी ऑल ऑफ अस नोज दैट इट इज इन द चार्ट, इट वॉज नंबर वन फ्यू ईयर्स बैक। सो when I talk about smart city and Bhubaneswar city was also designed post independence, to usme kya difference hai, is there any kind of differences in there and in terms of restoration of heritage buildings and in terms of smart city design, what elements you think must be there when the city is designed in a contemporary way, contemporary attitude like you said? Sir, I think you are on mute.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So I just want to answer you by asking you a reverse question.
Okay.
Tell me, is Banaras not smart? Is Puri not smart? Is Old Town Bhubaneswar not smart? Smart doesn't mean glass and steel. Smart means understanding of nature, understanding our ecology, our system, creating aesthetics which talks about our cultural understanding of life. Looking into the heritage part of it and in the smart city part of it, you see, heritage building to my mind is one which has striking architectural and artistic significance in respect of style, design, and use of construction materials, and which has great proven architectural qualities, aesthetic qualities, historic and cultural values. So heritage building may be temples, which are traditional buildings. It could be vernacular, our villages, our small houses, our tribal houses. It could be tangible and it could be intangible. So far as smart city is concerned, first let's not think that our old buildings are not smart, they're unsmart. So what appears to be smart is not really very smart, because if we all heard Mr. Upendra Behra, he spoke so much of adding technology into combining technology to traditional buildings. That is how is a need and making it energy efficient. But I want to add one sentence by telling what we should do in a smart city to old buildings. So I think the one sentence is preserve old and good, preserve old and good, build new and appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So there is a one question I should add to it, and that is from a participant. Can vernacular architecture in modern architecture design can be applied and can it survive the strength of time? I mean, how can you make combine vernacular architecture and modern architecture?
I think this is a question which is very close to my mind. First, let me define what is vernacular architecture or vernacular buildings. Vernacular was one which is not traditional, because vernacular is one where people build for themselves. Suppose a man builds for his own house traditionally, it's called vernacular architecture. So your vernacular architectural styles are our own identities. They are energy-wise normally efficient, because हमारा पुराना जमाने में जो घर था कोर्टयार्ड था दे इज टू बी वेरी सेंसिटिव एंड व्हेन वी आर ट्राइंग टू टॉक अबाउट वर्नाक्युलर आर्किटेक्चर दे आर नेवर ऑब्सोलीट दे विल नेवर बी ऑब्सोलीट बट वेल वी नीड मोर एफएआर वी नीड टॉल बिल्डिंग्स मोर पीपल टू बी अकोमोडेटेड लैंड प्राइसेस इंक्रीजिंग एटसेट्रा बट वर्नाक्युलर स्टाइल्स वर्नाक्युलर कंस्ट्रक्शन टेक्निक्स वर्नाक्युलर आर्किटेक्चरल एक्सप्रेशंस कैन बी reused, redefined, rebuilt in a contemporary format. My understanding, I have tried many of my buildings. I have used two styles in both work. Style number one, use traditional expression with contemporary materials. Style number two, use traditional, first is traditional materials and contemporary expressions. Second is contemporary materials with traditional expressions. Both will give you a traditional or vernacular expressions. But if you want me to ask one line answer, can tradition and modern coexist? Yes, it can very much. It can very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. That's awesome. Some that comes from Professor This is Ray, and that comes from experience that both things, the ancient things, we are talking about restorations of heritage buildings. Restorations means we are trying to make it, give it a kind of modern look. हम लोग इस तरह से बता सकते हैं. So modern design and vernacular design, that thing that defines our identity, they can coexist. But the thing is that we also have to be sensitive towards environment, like Lokendraji said. That आप कुछ भी कर लीजिए वट एवर यू डिजाइन आप रिस्टोर कर लीजिए या फिर नया चीज बनाइए कुछ भी बनाइए या फिर कोई नया चीज को बिल्ड करके तोड़ के बनाओ या वो पहला चीज को रिस्टोर करो वट एवर वी डू इट हैज टू बी सेंसिटिव एनफ टुवर्ड्स एनवायरमेंट एंड इट हैज टू बी बिल्ट इनटू द वेरी मच द हार्ट ऑफ द पीपल द ब्रेन ऑफ द पीपल आर्किटेक्ट्स हो प्रोफेशनल्स हो या फिर यंग हार्ट द स्मॉल द चिल्ड्रेंस तो पूरा उसी एजुकेशन लेवल से ये चीज आनी चाहिए सबके माइंड में धीरे धीरे अवेयरनेस जब बढ़ती जाएगी जो एसोचैम जेम वी आर ट्राइंग टू डू दैट सस्टेनेबिलिटी अवेयरनेस दैट इज द मेन एजेंडा बिहाइंड इंक्रीजिंग दैट काइंड ऑफ सस्टेनेबिलिटी अवेयरनेस टू अंडरस्टैंड एंड टू लेट द पीपल नो दैट यस ऑल दीज थिंग्स द एनवायरमेंटल फ्रेंडली इकोनॉमिकल फ्रेंडली आइडेंटिटी फ्रेंडली कंटेम्पररी डिजाइन आर पॉसिबल और वो हम लोग का गोल होनी चाहिए तभी जाके लाइफ आगे बढ़ेगी तभी जाके लाइफ सही तरीके से बढ़ेगी नेचुरल फ्रेंडली रहेंगे तो सो ये यहाँ पे इन दिस नोट वी वुड लाइक टू कंक्लूड दिस ऑडियंस इंटरेक्शंस इफ देयर इज एनीथिंग टू ऐड फ्रॉम लोकेंद्र जी और एसएस राय जी सर इफ यू वुड लाइक टू ऐड एनीथिंग अदरवाइज वी विल मूव टू द नेक्स्ट
सेशन थैंक यू वेरी मच
या थैंक यू सर सो हियर वी वुड लाइक टू गो टू द नेक्स्ट सेशन फॉर सस्टेनेबिलिटी पार्टनर मिस श्रीति पांडे जी द फाउंडर ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर इको सो she will be sharing there are a lot of things her company is doing in this direction environmental friendly direction so we'd like to hear from her over to you ma'am
thank you can you give the right to share my presentation
yeah, sure yeah. you have the rights right now Not yet. It's starting to share the content. It will take a little longer.
Is it visible?
Yeah, now it's visible. Yeah, now it's visible. You can make it. It's great.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to talk about what structure does. And I was just past speakers, and I loved that most of the architects and discussing about natural materials and how there needs to be a balance in the ecosystem. And that's where we rightly believe that we have to bring back natural materials, natural raw materials to build new sophisticated products that can be vernacular or modern building. If we really want to build better while we build at the scale that we are right now building, not just in India, but globally. I'll start with something before coming to buildings, which is stubble burning. So in India, as we all know, we are one of the largest producers of stubble. More than 500 million metric tons of and more than 40% of this is all of the major part of it is burned in North India, which is Punjab, Haryana. And when this burning happens, as one of my last speakers mentioned, it leads to increase in air pollution. They mentioned a fact saying that 70 lakh deaths happen every year in India due to air pollution. And the contribution of stubble burning to that air pollution is anywhere between 10 to 40% on a given day in winter in North India. Now this stubble, as I rightly mentioned, seems like a nuisance. We don't need it. It grows as a backdrop to cereals such as wheat, paddy, corn, maize, and we cannot stop it from growing. And hence the farmer has no need of it and ends up burning it. But what if there is a industry where this raw material is utilized, where it is not burnt, but a farmer is paid for it to sell it? And that industry, I believe the industry that we all are part of, buildings and construction. Now construction, after transportation, is the second largest producer of greenhouse gas emissions. I'd like to mention a number that I feel is more important than the overall carbon footprint of buildings, and that is the embodied carbon footprint. As most of us in this room know, that there is embodied and there is operational carbon footprint. Operational footprint is the footprint that a building generates because of its running, because of energy usage and other facilities. But the embodied footprint is the footprint of a building that is locked at the stage of construction. Once you decide the material that goes into building, as a designer, we cannot unlock it. You cannot remove the cement that has been used, or the brick, or the other carbon intensive materials. And that footprint is going to go up from 30% to 90% of the total footprint that a building generates, which means that as an architect, as a designer, and as a building material provider, we all have to come together and think about different materials that we can use, that we can specify, that do not add to this footprint. And what we do at Structure is we make such a material, which is called AgriBioPanel. It is a trademark product that we have, and we've been doing this for last 3.5 years in India. AgriBioPanel is basically an engineered panel that is made of straw instead of wood, and its use and application is very similar to any drywall material, which means you can use it as an alternate to gypsum, fiber cement board, plaster board, aluminium composite panels, WPC, as well as ply MDF. Now this panel, because it is similar to other fibers such as wood, has been modified in the manufacturing stage to make it termite proof, to make it moisture resistant. Naturally, straw has something that we have amplified over the manufacturing process, which is its ability to be thermally insulating. So our panels have a very high thermal insulating value. And secondly, there's a very high silica content that is present in straw. As most of us, when we look at news, we think that straw is easily burnt, but that is because it is loosely lying on the ground. But when you compress the straw under high pressure and temperature above 180 degrees centigrade, that silica gets released and binds with the straw itself and makes the final panel fire resistant. We have gotten the panels tested for fire, and we have received between 30 to up to 120 minutes fire rating for a 25 mm thick panel. And lastly, the most important aspect, that each and every square feet of these panels that we manufacture throughout its life cycle does not emit carbon but stores. Every square meter of this panel stores 30 kg of carbon dioxide. We have a negative carbon footprint. And the VOC emission, one of our panelists, Mr. Lokendra, architect Lokendra, he was talking about the toxicity, that almost every material that we use is toxic today. And I would like to mention that our panels have the lowest toxicity value. We'll share the test as well later in the presentation. But all the 7 most toxic gases that can be emitted, we have almost less than 0.00 presence of that in any of our product. This is a competition landscape of a panel against other materials. How does it outdo? Because sustainability is one aspect, but we understand that the product also has to meet all the required technical applications for which an architect might consider it for its usage. As I mentioned in the earlier slide, the fire resistance is up to 2 hours. We have a breaking load of 17.82, which is more than 3 times of the breaking load that a gypsum panel has, which translates that if you use these panels as a partition panel in your building, whether it's an office, a school, a hospital, you can easily mount a TV, you can mount an air conditioner, you can do any part of load on these panels with just the GI framing and the panel. You don't need additional support. No additional support is needed. Our acoustics value is also up above a 40. We got a panel tested by NPL, which is National Physical Laboratory in India, in Delhi, and we have received a minimum NRC of 0.7 on a basic acoustic panel, which are 12 mm thick and have standard perforation. And for our advanced acoustic design that we have, which we're also going forward and getting a design patent for, actually has achieved a 0.9 NRC. This is just a panel. And I would like to emphasize that usually when we talk about NRC, most products are able to achieve an NRC as a system, which means there's a frame, there's an air gap, and then there's a panel, an acoustic panel. And together that 2-inch or 3-inch of system achieves an NRC of 0.6 and 0.5. Here we are saying that just the panel can achieve that NRC. What does that mean? That means that you do not necessarily need for a regular office a lot of glass wool insulation. You can just have an air gap and the panel to reach that NRC. And even in a high performance building such as a theater or a studio, you need less insulation possible, because all of these insulating material that we have in the market are again extremely toxic and non-recyclable. I'm going to now show a lot of pictures of different actual projects that we have executed using this material in last 3 years in different parts of the country. This is a picture of a hospital based out of Bangalore called Jayadeva Hospital in JP Nagar, where we used our own panels for framing. What we did, we took a 30 mm thick panel of ours and cut them in 2-inch strip like a wood stud. And we used that 2-inch wide strip to make the frame. And then on top of that frame, we installed a 12 mm panel. And finally, the requirement of the hospital was to achieve a putty paint finish as well as a marble finish. Up to 3 feet height from the ground, we did a marble laminate on top of the panel, and the rest of it was a putty paint finish. In the center, you can also see there is glass that was installed, and we were able to hold that glass on the frame itself. And to the architect and the consumer, the final value was that they were able to build more than 30,000 square feet of partition in less than a month. We saved around 15% of the framing cost for the architect as compared to GI, while of course there was just no steel completely used in these partitions. And thirdly, the final solution that the customer achieved was more acoustically and thermally insulated. As you can see, there is no glass wool, no insulation used. But this final 2.5-inch partition was more insulated. This is a picture of another hospital that we did in Jalandhar in Punjab. It's a private hospital called Batra Hospital. It's more than 100-year-old hospital. And last year during COVID, they expanded their facility and built an additional 5,000 square feet space for patients and testing. And there, because of the time crunch, they needed to do the complete interior in less than 3 weeks, for which we suggested that we can give them a pre-finished panel where they don't have to do any painting. And all the partitions, all the wooden ceiling that you see in the picture, as well as the doors, are made of this Agri Bio panel. A 9 mm panel were used for ceiling, 12 mm for partition, and a 30 mm thick fireproof panel was used for the doors in the complete hospital. The false ceilings that we have come in 2 variants, 9 mm and 12 mm. Like any other finish, you can do wooden, you can do paint, or you can use the panels as raw. So the first picture that you see is of an international school in Gurgaon called Heritage International in DLF Phase 2, where the architect actually went for the raw finish of the panel, because his argument was that when I'm using a sustainable product, why should I use an extremely high VOC emitting paint on the panel? Why don't we keep it raw? Because that's when you're actually reducing your footprint and not adding to it. Our doors come in thicknesses of 25, 30, and 35, and we do provide fireproof doors, which means in any high traffic zone, such as a warehouse, a hospital, a school, you can usually use these doors as an alternative to a flush door. and still meet your sustainability requirement. These are pictures of the furniture. So our 12mm and 18mm panel can easily be used for making any furniture. Now, usually when we think about the furniture as an architect, we either think of ply or we think of MDF. MDF where we need variety of finishes, and ply when we want to give strength to a wardrobe or a shelf. Now, this is where I want to mention that the AgriBio panel has the strength of the ply and the usability and versatility of MDF, because you can paint, you can do duco, you can do polish, you can do lacquer, you can put veneer, laminate, all sort of finish on these panels. There is no limitation. All kind of CNC woodwork is possible on this panel, similar to MDF. While when we talk about the screw holding capacity and the density of these panels, it is more than what is there for an MDF, which means you're getting the strength for a wardrobe and a shelf, and you're getting the versatility when you're using it as a table or interesting furniture in a hospital or in a hotel in different facilities. These are some of the pictures of the furniture that we have done for different clients. And it's all made out of AgriBio panel. There is no wood, not at all used in any of these pictures. Now, this is what Structure believes that we need to do. And this is where we need a lot of people and a lot of partners in the ecosystem to come together. We currently are making our panels out of bagasse and paddy straw. By the end of next year, we'll add wheat and coconut to our portfolio, which means we'll be able to make our AgriBio panel not just out of paddy, but wheat and coconut waste as well. All of these panels will further be E0 certified. Currently, all our products are E1 certified. In India, 90% of MDF, ply, and particle board is E2 certified, which is the percentage of formaldehyde content in a panel. We are already better than that, but we are further going to be E0 by next year itself. And thirdly, we are doing a lot of R&D in-house as well as in collaboration with institute based in India as well as outside in Europe. One of them is based out of Finland, where we are trying to see how we can further make these panels so water resistant that if you soak this panel in for 24 hours, it absorbs less than 1% moisture. And if we are able to achieve that, then these panels would also be good for using of any exterior application, which means where you use a high pressure laminate that is made out of or synthetic material, you can use these panels for your external facade. So that's the roadmap for Structure, where we want to increase the application from interior to exterior. We are very clear that we'll never use a raw material that isn't natural, that isn't upcycling of waste. Don't use any sort of non-toxic synthetic artificial raw material for manufacturing. And lastly, the whole manufacturing of our material is completely clean, which means we don't use any fossil fuel to generate energy. It's the same straw that we use to generate energy to manufacture further these panels, which is why the overall life cycle of these panels, whether the raw material, which is upcycled, manufacturing, which is green, and the final product, all ends up storing carbon instead of emitting. And that's how we believe that there has to be material like AgriBio panel that can help for a designer to use the to reach the green standard. It is a very important component, and the previous panelists as well, that unless that is done, we cannot be really green. This is a small slide about the team that we have at Structure and also about the various recognition that we have achieved. We have won the Green Project Award by Smart City Expo in 2019. We've been featured by all the national newspaper that was there, including Forbes. And we have IITs and IIMs supporting us in what we are doing at building this product. And our long-term goal is to make a mainstream product that is green, because unfortunately, if we look at the Indian market, there are a lot of new products that are there, but no product is able to compete with a mainstream carbon intensive product, where we need a product digitized with all the technical features, and it's also palatable in an aesthetic form, which is where we believe that because these panels can easily be painted, all sort of which is possible. We are not limiting an architect. We are not asking an architect to compromise when they are specifying these panels for any application, but actually they are adding more value to the application, both in terms of performance as well as the sustainability aspect. And lastly, that's the philosophy that Structure abides with and all the products that we currently have and believe to have in future, where we do believe that waste is only a waste if you waste it. And we believe there's a lot of waste that is available, not just agri, but a lot of construction demolition waste, which we are planning to start doing R&D upon from next year in collaboration with IT Kanpur. And as a company, we want architects to look at us, not just a material provider, but also as an R&D partner, where we can work with them and we can come up with new products based on the local requirements, based on the raw materials that are locally available. I'll just give a short example. We were only using paddy and bagasse, and then when we expanded to the south market, we felt that it does not make sense to promote a raw material that is not locally available. And then we did R&D on coconut. And from first quarter of 2022, we'll have a product which meets all the same performance standards, but it will be made out of coconut and paddy waste. Similarly, in the Northeast, we are already doing R&D in Meghalaya and Nagaland. How can we make a product that a composite of paddy and coconut? Because those are the two fibers that are locally available in Northeast. So the idea is to use local raw material, build local market and local consumption, which is where we need architects from Pan India, whether they're in Orissa, in Northeast, in South, or North of India, to use a material to specify it for it to promote. I'll in the chat share my email address, and I would really request anybody who's right now listening to this presentation that I had, that if you're an architect, if you're a designer, please write to us, and we'll be more than happy to send you our free samples of different applications. And we would like to sit with you and understand your applications and see how we can get it specified and for you to at least use it in one project, if not many. And that, I think, can be a small start for us to promote something that is genuinely green, whether it is at the material level or in terms of its final life. And that's where I think we can make a genuine dent in the construction industry. I am happy to take any questions if you have regarding the material, performance, what certificates do we have. We can talk about that, and I'll be more than happy to address all of those queries.
Thank you, Sudhiji. Waste is only a waste if you waste it. That's a great message from you. And we really give you all our good wishes to your team, the dedicated team, natural resources, your clear roadmap for it up to 2024 or 2025. So that's the beauty of UTK. If you can just send your email ID in the chat box, all the participants can get it immediately. And
I shared my email.
Yeah, one thing I'd like to say you here, that we have a product like in Association Gem, we also have a product certifications program. So which also recognizes like environmental impact, social impacts, global impacts, cost impacts, indigenous to India. And it seems like all these things, when you're talking about sustainability parameters, this product is really beautiful. And I have used certain products in my past projects, like dry wall partitions and everything, and it really works. Thank you very much for this participations, for this beautiful presentations, and it completely complements our sessions today, restoration of heritage buildings. Thank you very much for that. And so today, right now, we'll move on to our next sessions of vote of thanks. But before going that to the sessions, I would like to give a special thanks to Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Council of Architecture, NBT India, and NAREDCO. We are also thankful to our sustainable partners, again, including but not limited to Principal Piping, Pipings and Fittings, Lubrizol, Panasonic India, Mehta Tubes, ALP, Inner Engineering, Daikin India, JSW, and Alliance. And we are almost at the end of this session, so please stay tuned for our vote of thanks. So our next speaker is Professor Sangram Mahanti, who is co-chairman, Association Chem Odisha Chapter, architect, MEP, and green consultant. Welcome to you, sir, and over to you for a beautiful, the summing up and summarizing the sessions in your own words and for the vote of thanks session. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Association Chem Gujarat and Odisha Chapter, it gives me immense pleasure and privilege to propose a word of thanks on this occasion. I take the opportunity to express my sincere gratitude to our guest of honor, Sri Pundres Modi ji, Cabinet Minister, Road and Building Transport, Civil Aviation, Tourism and Pilgrims Development, Government of Gujarat. Thank you, sir, for your inspiration and encouraging message on this special day. I also extend my heartfelt gratitude to Sri Upendranath Behra ji, IAS, Chairman, Odisha State Electricity Regulatory Commission, Government of Odisha, to take out time from his busy schedule to grace the event. It was intended to have a fresh insight into heritage and also use of solar energy. Thank you, sir, for your thought-provoking and inspiring address. I extend my thanks to Mr. Pankaj Dharkarji, Chairman, ASSOCHAM JAM Green Building Council. Sir, your leadership in taking ASSOCHAM JAM to another level is highly commendable. I would also like to extend my thanks to Architect Anand Tatuji, Chairman, ASSOCHAM JAM Gujarat Chapter. Sir, your leadership is highly marked as the state is seeing many green buildings and responsible ways in shaping it for future generation. Your presentation on retaining heritage building is noteworthy. I'd also like to thank our distinguished speaker, Professor S.S. Rai, Chairman, ASSOCHAM Odisha Chapter. Sir, your presentation on living with layers and connecting cultural heritage with urbanscape was excellent. You have always been an inspiration for all the youngsters. And today you showed us a responsive way of building in an appropriate layer. I'm sure Odisha will see many such green buildings under your leadership in the days ahead. I also extend my thanks to our distinguished speaker, Architect Lokendra Valesiria, Co-Chairman ASSOCHAM JAM Gujarat Chapter, for making a wonderful presentation. Sir, we are certainly looking forward for many more thoughtful, provoking presentation ahead. I would also like to thank Ms. Shriti Pandey, founder Structure Eco, for a wonderful presentation and use of straw as a building material. I'd also like to express my gratitude to all the esteemed delegates and participants of the webinar for the presence and contribution in making the webinar a great success. My heartfelt thanks to all our sponsors, partners, and supporting associates for supporting this occasion and making it a grand success. And last, not the least, I would also like to thank Mr. Neeraj Arora ji, Senior Director, Mr. Subrata Ratha, Coordinator, Moderator, Joint Director, ASSOCHAM JAM Green Building Certification Program, and Mr. Harish Puspakar and his team for working hard for the past few days to make this webinar a successful. So let us come together to create a green and sustainable world. With this message, I conclude. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Joshi, our team, and all the ASSOCHAM JAM members, wish you a successful time forward. And we have another webinar coming up. Rajji, if you can set the slide, it will be at 2:30 PM today for the Kerala chapter. So it will be based on refuse, reuse, and recycling of materials. So that would be, please stay tuned at 2:30. This is the content of that message, 2:30 to 4 PM for a holistic grid development. So please stay tuned, participants, and we'll have a lot of things to gather in this all the sessions. And we already had two sessions, one from Maharashtra and Karnataka team, one of Gujarat and the Odisha chapters, and we have a lot more to learn. Thank you very much. So here we can wrap up this event. Harish, you can conclude the event. Thank you very much.